Jesus tells us how we know if we love him. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Are you keeping his commandments? Are you living holy? That's what it means to actually be a Christian. Being a Christian is not just, because you go to church most Sundays. Being a Christian is not, well, your granddad was a pastor, so that makes you a Christian. Being a Christian is not saying a little sinner's prayer at Bible camp when you were 9 and then thinking you get to live the rest of your life just in debauchery and wickedness. No, being a Christian means that Jesus said, you must take up your cross daily and follow me. Jesus said, you must take up your cross daily and follow me. The cross is an instrument of death. The cross is an instrument of death. When you follow Jesus, when you claim to be a Christian, you're dying to yourself and you're living for Christ. And that's what the Apostle Paul said, for me to die is Christ and to live is gain. He said, if I die, hey, I get to be with Jesus in person. If I live, I get to serve Jesus down here. Are you serving Jesus? You know, we've talked a lot about idolatry today. I think there's a lot of people that are living in idolatry today. You think it's not... You know, you think idolatry is just like back centuries ago when they had golden calves and totem poles and, you know, stone statues that they bowed down to and everything. No, idolatry is when you put anything above God with your time, your money, and your passion. I said it earlier, you want to find out what someone loves? You want to find out what someone loves? Find out what they spend their time and their money and their passion on. You find out what somebody spends their time, their money, and their passion on, and you will find out what they love. Because that's what you do. When you have free time, when you have disposable income, when you have passion, you will spend it on the things that you love. And when you love drunkenness, and when you love debauchery, and you love just frivolous, meaningless entertainment, and you do more with your money and your time and your passion on frivolous entertainment than you do on the cause of Christ, that is idolatry. Something's wrong. Something's out of whack. You know, praise God, he's given us this time. I think the last year and a half of COVID and all the shutdowns and all this other garbage, you know, the wearing 5 masks and getting shot up with who knows what substances and all this other garbage and shutting down businesses and closing down sporting events and all this stuff or whatever. You know, I think that was God giving us a chance to see the practice run that the world is having on what the end times are going to be like. And what are you doing with it? Are you learning from it? Are you preparing your family? Are you preparing your heart? Are you preparing your home for when the tribulation actually does come? I thank God. I thank God that the world was only capable of having a test run at this whole Mark of the Beast business. But next time it comes around, imagine. Look at what happened with an illness that has a 99.8% survival rate. The whole world shut down and everything went nuts over a disease that has a 99.8% survival rate. You know, they still have vials of smallpox, even though there's no smallpox outbreaks anywhere. In labs, they still have vials of smallpox just to test it. Instead of just getting rid of it and having the world be done with smallpox, scientists still have small vials on it for testing. You know, they could unleash that garbage again. That's got a 40% kill rate. A COVID had a 0.2% kill rate. Smallpox has a 40% kill rate. And they could come up with something far more. What's going to happen when the next disease comes out? It's got a 50% kill rate. A 50% kill rate. You know how nuts this world is going to go? You know how nuts this world is going to go? You're not going to have a chance. You're not going to even be able to drive to Walmart before it's already cleaned out and a bunch of riots going on outside. The world's about to go nuts. You got to get your heart prepared. You better be right with God. You better be right with God today. You know, the Christian life is a long, straight life that's actually going somewhere. Unlike a NASCAR race that just keeps going around in circles and round and oval and around and around and around. See, a NASCAR race just just goes around and around and around. You know where it ends up? Right where it started. Right back where it started. Doesn't really get you anywhere. Frivolous entertainment, so be it. You know, but the Christian life isn't like a NASCAR race. It's actually going somewhere. It's actually going towards something. It's going towards Christ. It's going towards bringing, while we're down here, bringing this lost and dying world to salvation, telling lost and dying people about Jesus Christ and about salvation. It's about getting our heart right. It's about, you know, the Bible says to rend your hearts and not your garments. The Jews would always make an outward sign, and they would tear their clothing as a sign that they were so repentant and sorrowful and full of anguish, and they would rip their clothing, and it was just a show. It was just for people to see, and God knew where their hearts were, and God understands when people are full of garbage. It's like if your heart is full of garbage, God's not fooled. God's not fooled by you saying you're sorry on Sunday morning, knowing full well you're going to go back out and get drunk Monday through Saturday all over again. Go back out Monday through Saturday looking at porn and fornicating and all of that. God's not stupid. He knows where your heart is. That's what God said. God said, rend your hearts and not your garments. God wants you to be broken over your sin. God's not interested in what you do for show. God's not interested in what you do at, you know, some phony altar call just to look good at your church. God's not interested in the fact that you threw a 20. You were so awesome that you threw a 20 in the collection plate. No, God wants to know where your heart. God wants control of your heart. That Jesus himself, he had said, that to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Let's look at those. We've got to love God with our mind. We've got to be sober-minded. You know, you guys aren't sober-minded when you're out here staggering around on, you just had down to 12-pack of Coors Light. That's not sober-minded. You can't love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Your mind when you're wasted on booze. You know, you got to love God with all of your heart. You have to be broken. That's one thing America sorely lacks, is any brokenness over sin. We mention a sin when there's a big crowd out here, and everybody goes crazy. Woohoo! They cheer. Nobody cheers for the preaching, but when you say something about getting drunk and late, everybody's woohoo! Party time! You relish and you cheer for sin, and the Bible even talks about that you strengthen the hands of sinners so that none does turn. Shame on you. Do you understand that? You know, and Jesus even said that if you cause one of his little ones to stumble, it would be better that a millstone be tied around your neck and you'd be cast into the depths of the sea. Heaven forbid I see any of you moms or dads with little kids who cheer when we talk about, you know, don't be a drunk and getting laid, and people are cheering. And then you high-five somebody next to you because you're all drunk and you think it's hilarious. And you high-five your friend and you think your friends are going to think you're so awesome because you're drunk. No, you need to rend your heart and not your garment. Don't be cheering for each other. There's got to be brokenness. That's what God wants. And that's what we said before. You know, Jesus himself tells us that most people are going to end up in hell. Jesus said, broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many go that way. Narrow is the path, straight is the gate that leads to everlasting life, and few there be that find it. You know, you come to the Bible Belt, and the Bible Belt of America, the NASCAR race, almost everybody thinks they're a Christian. Everybody's a Christian. Everybody's a Christian out here at a NASCAR race in the Bible Belt. But you know that Jesus said that most people are on the broad road to destruction? Please, please, I implore you on Christ's behalf, stop assuming that you're on the narrow path that leads to everlasting life. When Jesus himself says that broad is the road to destruction, and many, most will go that way. Take a look inside. When you're inside that racetrack, take a look inside that racetrack. I don't think it'll be at capacity today, but I think it's about 150,000 people or some crazy number that thing can fill if it's at capacity. I know it's well over 100,000. Imagine if it's at capacity today, and look around every section inside that racetrack. Slowly and carefully look around at every section inside that racetrack. You know how many people out of that are probably on their way to heaven? Probably about the number of people who are waiting for nachos at one nacho stand. That's probably about the amount of people that are actually going to make it into heaven out of an entire racetrack. I'm not talking about specifically about today and these people, but I'm saying to understand that, you know, great, that you know, your love for Jesus Christ and your obedience to him must be great, must be pure. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Are you keeping his commandments? Don't give me this garbage that you said a sinner's prayer at Bible camp and think that's going to get you to your death at 85, living a life of sin. No. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. You come out here and, you know, this is getting close. What time is it here? Let's see. How close are we to Green Flag? We're about 2 hours away from Green Flag. This is when all the drunkards are kind of putting out the charcoal at their tailgate party and, you know, chugging down that last Coors Light at their bumper and making their way over to the track. Pretty soon, we'll have all the staggering drunks over here. You think you're okay with God? He said to be sober-minded. Anybody plan on getting drunk out here tonight? Plan on that guy? That guy wears a shock. That guy getting drunk? Your friend's gonna high-five you? Your friend's gonna high-five you when you're drunk? You drunk yet? Yeah, see, you know, your friends aren't gonna be there on Judgment Day to protect you from God's wrath. You know, your friends aren't going to be there to high-five you and tell God how awesome and cool a dude you are because you guys partied and got drunk, you know, every weekend you could get together and half the Tuesdays and Wednesdays. No, your friends aren't going to be there to protect you on Judgment Day. Your pastor is not going to be there to protect you and defend you on Judgment Day. Your youth group leader is not going to be there to protect you on Judgment Day. On Judgment Day, it's going to be you and God, mano a mano, face to face, but you're not going to be able to say a word. You're not going to say a word on Judgment Day, because on Judgment Day, God is only going to say one of two things to people, one of two things after the books are open and he sees where you fall, and he's going to say either, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into thy rest. That's what I want to hear. I can't wait. I hope, the Bible says that, that one day every tongue will confess, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I can't wait for that day, because while I'm down here in this cesspool called earth that we're living in now, this cesspool of sin called earth, I've already bowed my knee gladly, and I gladly confessed with my tongue that Jesus Christ is Lord. I've done it down here, stuck in this cesspool of sin called earth. I can't wait to actually get to see him face to face and say it to him. I will gladly bow my knee before Jesus, gladly profess him as Lord. But you understand that if you die as an unrepentant sinner, your knee is still going to bow, probably because your legs are going to be taken out from under you with trembling and fear, and your tongue is still going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, but you're going to say it with sheer terror. You know, if you die as a Christian, you can say those words with joy and glee. But if you die as an unrepentant sinner, you're still going to confess to Jesus' face that he's Lord, but you're going to do it in sheer terror. It'll be the only words you get to say to him. What a shame. Can you imagine living 85 years of your life thinking you're going to spend eternity in heaven while you lived a life of debauchery and nonsense, only to have that the first words that you ever get to hear from Jesus are, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you." Those are the only two options. They're going to happen on Judgment Day. Either Jesus is going to say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into thy rest," or he's going to say, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, you sinner, I never knew you." Do you understand? It's going to be most people. Don't let that be you. Don't let that be you. God's brought us out here today. We all have other things we could be doing. I praise God. He gives us the opportunity to love and serve him. I don't want to be here, quite honestly. I'm sick of people, quite honestly. I don't want to be out here, but I get to come out here and I get to tell you about Jesus Christ. I won't be sick of you in God's kingdom. No, that'll be awesome. Let's repent and let's praise God together. Let's get right with God, and then we can enjoy each other's company and fellowship in the sight of an almighty God and his holy angels. But if you die as an unrepentant sinner, you're going to have there's no second chance. There's no hope. None of us are promised tomorrow. You could die tomorrow. You could die tonight. You might not even see the green flag. The green flag is still a couple hours away. Green flag is still a couple hours away. You might not even survive. You could get run over by a bus. Look at these buses going back and forth. You know, maybe you're not paying attention. You're staggering around because you finish off your 12 Coors Light. You get run over by a bus. This very day, your life might be demanded of you. That happened in the Bible. there was a rich man, and he had great crops, and he said, I know what I'll do. I'm going to tear down these old junky barns. I'm going to build new ones and store all my grain, and I'm going to live high on the hog for many, many years. And God said, you fool, you fool. This very night your life will be demanded of you. That could be you. Quit being frivolous with your own eternal soul. Get right with God today. You're not promised tomorrow. You could die crossing this street. You could die of a heart attack. You could die of some gangbanger busting a cap in you. You could die of 100 different ways this very night. This day, this today's day, could actually be the second date on your tombstone. Do you understand that? There's nothing stopping that from happening. Between now and midnight, this date, today's date, what is this, May 30th? You don't even know what day it is, I'm not asking you. this very date, today, could be the second date on your tombstone. You don't even know it yet. Get right with God. Don't think that you're right with God because you went to church last Sunday or because you said a sinner's prayer. No. Do we have anybody planning on getting drunk tonight? Anybody planning on getting drunk tonight? You're in a lot of trouble with God. The Bible says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Alan, you about ready? A couple minutes, get ready. The Bible says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither idolater, nor adulterer, nor fornicator, nor homosexual offender, nor drunkard, nor thief, nor slanderer, nor swindler will inherit the kingdom of God. Folks, you've got to get off that list. You're in a lot of trouble.